Hello everyone. In this session, we'll get a clear and precise idea of what is an embedded system. Because indeed, if we are studying the microcontrollers, the basic purpose of studying this is to study about the embedded system. And we have also heard about it a lot. So let's see what an embedded system is actually. Okay. So in this session, our basic objective is to understand what is an embedded system, to just drop it down to some generalized block diagram, how it works, what are the components of this embedded system, what are the hardware components, what are the software components, and what kind of processors are used in the embedded system. So to get a complete generalized idea of the embedded system, that's the overall agenda of this session. So let's get started. If we have to define the embedded system, actually I don't like definitions as such, but if I have to define the embedded system, there can be a lot of difficult ways and a lot of different ways to define the embedded systems. So here it goes. It's a system that has embedded software and computer hardware, which makes it a system dedicated for an application or specific part of an application or a complete product or part of a larger system. In short, what I mean to say by embedded system is it's any system which has a programmable element or programmable circuit inside it and which is created or which is developed to perform one particular dedicated task. For example, if you take the comparison of laptop and MP3 player, a laptop is a computer system. It's a complete computer used for number of different applications and number of different works. But an embedded system, which is MP3 player, is dedicated to only play MP3s. Yes, of course, some related tasks can be added like recording some audios and playing FM radio. But the major part or the dedicated application is playback of MP3 files. So that's the basic difference. The MP3 player gives us the same precision, the same reliability, the same quality as that of a computer, but in a smaller size as well as in a smaller price. That's what embedded systems are for. This is a very generalized block diagram of embedded system, and it can be applied to any system in particular. So the core of this embedded system is a CPU or central processing unit. It can be anything. It can be a microprocessor, a controller, FPGA, CPLD, or any kind of processing element can be used. Definitely then, to this CPU, there is some input and some output. The output may be from some actuators, some indicators, a lot of things are there. Input can be coming from human interface like the switches or keypads or some sensors which can be directly connected to CPU, or there can be some A-to-D conversion. This particular programmable element does has a software inside it, and it also has some memory associated with it where the software is residing. Look, every single block that is shown here, D2A converter, A2D converter, human interface, diagnostic, auxiliary, all these blocks are optional. Remember, the basic part is CPU with some input, some output, and some software processing associated with it. Then based upon the application, the input-output blocks will change, the interfaces will change. So that's a generalized embedded systems block diagram. We're talking about here as computers. An embedded system has a CPU inside it, as you can see. So what it is basically is a computer. But the normal computer or PCs or laptops are generally used as a application or a system to perform number of different things, whereas embedded system is there to perform only one dedicated task. Often in this kind of embedded system, reliability is very critical. The resources, that is memory, processor, and capacity, are also limited, and often real-time response is essential. Now let me give you an example for it. Consider if your laptop gets hanged sometimes, okay, and what you do? We generally wait for some time, we do something like control, alt, delete, and we do those kind of things, and we wait for the computer to respond. Now tell me, a normal cheaper mobile phone that is in your hands, if it gets hanged, what do? We immediately start tapping it on our hand, isn't it? Now see, the price of mobile phone is less, we know that the processing power of that mobile phone is less, but what we want is it should act as real time as possible. And a little bit of hang in mobile is not allowed. In laptop or computer, it's allowed. We will restart it, we will go grab some coffee, come back after some time, and then we will be resuming our work. But a mobile phone is not expected to hang. And the same thing goes for all the embedded system. And that is why designing embedded system is a challenging task. What are the applications of embedded system? Embedded system is everywhere. You just list down or you just think of any industry, embedded system is applicable into that. To name a few, here are some application criterias or definitions that we have. Communications, we all know that in satellites, in telephone systems, in internet, in optical fiber communication, cellular, everywhere there are tiny bits of embedded systems used for a number of different applications. Automotive being one of the most important application and something where we can say embedded system originated. Today's automotive has a number of different sensors and microprocessing elements which are used and are working in conjunction with each other to generate some really, really time effective as well as critical application. Like it may be the headlight turning on and off automatically, or the windshield operating, or the central locking system, or the remote locking system, or the what we can say that for the speed control system. There are many such applications. There is an engine control unit itself inside the car which controls all the sensors. We all know about the consumer electronic appliances, which are the examples of embedded systems, like digital cameras, washing machine, gaming consoles, clocks, games and toys, microwave oven, this kind of applications. In medical, there are many applications, like starting from a very small heartbeat meter to the complicated ECG system and the MRI system. There are many such systems which are part of, which themselves are either embedded system or they are consisting of number of different smaller embedded systems. Industrial applications are a very wide variety of embedded systems. What you see here is a programmable logic controller, which is a very classic and very widely used embedded application used in industry. Then there are variable frequency drives, radio remote control units, thermostats, traffic control system, robotic system, barcode reader, and so. The list will go on and on. And in the same way, the applications of embedded systems can be found in the defense system. Again, the embedded systems are combined with number of different mechanical systems to create the end application. So as discussed before, the responsibility of embedded system design is often that it should be real time. It should give a very reactive operation. It should have as small size and as less weight as possible. It should be safe and reliable. It should be easily usable in harsh environment. For example, mobile phone, if we talk about, works for 24 hours a day. We hardly switch it off, and if sometime our phone gets switched off, we can panic and we find the charger and we power it on as soon as possible. So a harsh environment application, 24-hour application is expected from an embedded system. And of course, it's needed that it should be a cost-sensitive instrument. The design requirements of embedded systems basically are the choice or selection of central processing unit, the selection of embedded operating system, or we can say embedded software, and the selection of peripheral. Now, selection of peripheral will always depend upon the application. But we can definitely study the central processing unit and the software systems which are used in embedded systems. The most important, the CPU or the processing element in an embedded system is a microcontroller. Now, it's often compared with microprocessor, and it's very interesting to understand how microprocessor operates and how a microcontroller operates. Now, every one of us might have seen a motherboard. At least we are using at least a laptop or a desktop for a number of different applications. We all know that there is a big board inside that computer, which we call as motherboard. And onto that motherboard, there are a number of different smaller items like RAM or ROM or IO port or serial device or hard disk connector, serial port connector. And on the center of that motherboard somewhere, the processor is installed or mounted. Can you understand that a microprocessor on its own does not do anything? But in order to function this microprocessor, we need a big motherboard with a number of different chips onto the board. The classic example starts from Intel x86 to today's Intel Pentium processors, as well as the Core i3, i5 processors and that sort of things. This is a generalized or general purpose microprocessor system block diagram which we use in computers. The microprocessor doesn't work on its own and it requires a big motherboard to operate, which in turn increases the size of the hardware as well as the cost of the hardware. On the other hand, the microcontroller is a single chip system which has a processing unit on chip, some little amount of RAM, some little amount of ROM, input-output ports, timer, serial port, and many such peripherals are embedded onto a single chip. And because many things are embedded on single chip, there are two problems with it. First, there are not problems but two things associated with it. First is the resources would be limited in size. So the RAM, ROM cannot be increased. They are by default present inside the IC. Second thing, being on a single wafer, the price of the overall system is drastically reduced. So that is the reason in smaller embedded systems, microcontroller is the most preferred choice for development. Choosing a microcontroller is definitely a very trivial task because there are many microcontrollers out there in the market. There are a number of different terms associated with it, like 8-bit controller, 16-bit controller, 32-bit controller, this much megahertz of speed, this much of RAM, ROM, and this much of IO pins. What we have to do whenever we are starting a project is sit down and look for all the features that we expect in a particular controller. Common features are speed grid, which is specified in megahertz. Then the task at hand. Is it possible to be done by 8-bit controller or 16-bit or 32-bit controller? Depending upon the task at hand, we can judge how much amount of RAM and ROM do we need. Depending upon the number of peripherals we have to interface, we have to decide how many number of input-output pins are we going to need. Then lastly, it should be easy to upgrade the system for a higher performance processor. For example, if we have a PCB created for a particular system, then it should be easily upgradable. The processor on that PCB should be just remove the first one, insert the second one with some additional features. Then the packaging should be available, like the processor we are choosing should be available in both through-hole as well as SMD sizes. Depending on application, you will use through-hole, or to save the size, you will use SMD. And last but most important is power consumption. If you are creating a battery-powered application, then power consumption is a very crucial thing to consider. Of course, if you are creating an application which runs on AC mains, I don't think so power consumption is that big issue for us. So we have to select, or we have to look for these technical things while choosing a microcontroller. Of course, there are some commercial aspects also while choosing the microcontroller, like what should be the cost per unit, how easily it is available across the world. For example, if I'm creating a system here in India and if I'm shipping that and it has to work in France, then definitely the repairs or the maintenance or the chip upgrades should be available equally in India as well as France, or for that matter, any country in the world. Then availability of software development tools. No one will want to use a microcontroller for which a software tool is not available at all. So we want a software development tool available, and as much as possible, it should be cheaper or much better if free of cost. Same goes for the hardware development tools such as device programmer or debugger. These hardware tools, first of all, should be available. Second, if possible, they should be available at a cheaper price. Third, if possible, they should be so easy that we can download the program at home or by just connecting it to computer. So these are some commercial aspects we need to study and we need to take care about when we are choosing a microcontroller for a particular system. These are some top 10 microcontroller manufacturers. Now, this is just a formulated list which was done a few years ago. There are no such criterias of defining who is the top manufacturer. But of course, Renesas remains the topmost because of their sale in the automotive domain. Rest, there are many names in the semiconductor manufacturing which are into the microcontroller creation. Now, Let's see what is exactly 8051, which is the heart, which is the core of this entire study. 8051 is the microcontroller core which was created by Intel. It was introduced in 1981. So let's see what is exactly this 8051 that we are talking about, which is the core of this study. 8051 is the microcontroller architecture which was introduced by Intel, referred to as MCS51 family, in 1981. It became very popular because of its simple architecture. It was available very cheap and the development tools were readily available. So from the development of 8051 itself, it became very, very popular across the world. So popular that Intel was unable to fulfill the entire requirement. What Intel did then is Intel licensed the architecture. And because of the licensed architecture, what happened is today there are many manufacturers of 8051. In fact, Intel no more manufactures the 8051, but there are many other licensed manufacturers which develop the 8051 based controller, like Analog Devices, Altera, Atmel, which is now taken by Microchip, Texas Instruments, Cypress Semiconductor, Maxim Integrated, and there are such more than 70 different manufacturers who develop the 8051. So definitely it makes sense to study about the 8051 architecture. Every manufacturer adds some of his own features. For example, Analog Devices is famous in A2D converter. So they add A2D converter to 8051. Atmel will add some wireless things to 8051 and so on. Embedded software means the software which we write down for the chosen microcontroller generally is one of these two types. Either it's an assembly language code or it's a higher language or higher level language programming or coding. Assembly language coding is something which is written in the generic assembly instructions of that microcontroller. Every microcontroller manufacturer gives us some instruction sets for use with that microcontroller. And what we have to do is we have to write down a logic or a sequence or job or task using that instructions. This program written using instructions is called as an ALP. Or assembly language programming. While it is the most efficient coding technique because the code generated is for the exact purpose, as well as free assemblers are provided by the manufacturer, the issue is it takes a whole lot of time to study the entire assembly instruction set of a particular controller. Secondly, there is no portability at all. So if I'm developing a code for 8051 microcontroller in assembly for several years now, and if I immediately shift my job and if I go to some other company which doesn't use 8051, then my entire assembly language programming knowledge is zero. I have to again start with new processor, study its architecture and learn the instruction. That is why in today's world, usage of assembly language programming is very, very restricted because it's not portable. The debugging is difficult and it's usually considered good for only the small level projects. Now, what is the other way of writing down program? Other way of writing down program is usage of a higher level language like C, Java, C++ or Pascal. While there are many such embedded languages available, C is the most popular of them all. The code generated in C language is definitely bulky because there is a software which is converting a C program into the respective assembly program. But the C programming is portable. You can easily shift a particular code written for one microcontroller to the other microcontroller. The efficiency is nice. You can create a C program for a particular project in really, really less time. And it's suitable for small to larger projects. For every microcontroller that are generated, there are definitely some C compilers available for them, either from the manufacturer itself or from the third party devices or third party providers. So generally C language is preferred, and throughout this course also we are going to use C language for programming the 8051 microcontroller. So that's it for this session. We have taken a clear idea of an embedded system. What we are going to do is we are going to study the 8051 based embedded system by connecting some peripherals as input and output to it and writing down some software program for it in the embedded C language. Thanks for watching this video.